Here, this is Žižek in 2009 commenting on the NATO bombings in Serbia and other interventions.
This may surprise you. I'm differentiated here. That is to say, to the horror of many of my leftist friends, I supported NATO bombing of Yugoslavia.
He's fucking good, dude. Oh my god, I love him so goddamn much. Holy shit.
Because I think, and I said something for which some people were
hurt. I can't believe, dude, lefties should just never talk about foreign policy ever. If you're a leftist and you have an opinion on foreign policy, you should just shut up, okay? Go apple bobbing. Just do anything else. Because, like, I heard about the NATO intervention in Yugoslavia as some kind of, like, monstrous Western intervention. And the more I read about it, the more justified it was. It was like, oh, they were doing an ethnic cleansing, millions of people being kicked out of the country. Oh, they were indiscriminately shelling the countryside and doing mass executions, and there were mass graves found. Oh, there were multiple attempts to reason with Serbia beforehand and try to get them to withdraw or to get them to, like, submit to an intervention from the UN with inspections, and their only prerequisite was that they withdraw their troops from the occupied, like, Kosovo areas. A couple, like, I think around, like, maybe 1,000 people died from the, civilians died from the bombings, but there were already tens of thousands of deaths from the genocide, with many more piling up, like, every single day. And they were doing everything in their power to avoid, like, having to stop, and all the Serbians, dude, the Serbian government was literally, like, drinking blood. They were insane. This was not, like, some, like, half and half back and forth conflict or whatever. The Serbian government was like frothing at the mouth to slaughter and Albanians. It was insane. It was certainly more justified than they did in places like Iraq or Afghanistan. No, dude, they're not even comparable. They're not even comparable. Not even remotely. The NATO intervention in Yugoslavia is completely incomparable to the Iraq invasion. They're not even on the same wavelength. It's so different. Do you guys remember the debate that I had with that pro-Serbia guy who was, like, basically pro the mass slaughter of Albania? Because, like, every question that I would ask, it would be like, oh yeah, haha, well, maybe this shouldn't have happened. You know, I felt like I was talking to a Holocaust denier. Jesus. Sounds like Serbia was doing a Nazi Germany 2.0. Oh, the Serbs are all Nazis. Every one of them.
Fight. I said, maybe we need more interventions, but the right ones. For example, take Congo today. It's such an absolute nightmare. 5 million people died in the last 10 years for an actual...
I would totally be in favor of Western intervention in the Congo, because I don't actually think it could get any worse. Is that... I think we've reached that point. The cool thing about the Congo is that I don't actually think it's possible for things to get worse. So the intervention can only make things better, right? It's so f***ed over there, yeah.
Causes it. I would say even if the devil comes just to break this, but typically United States will not intervene there because nobody cares about Congo, no, and so on. So I would say that...
My dad served with Doctors Without Borders in Kosovo. He described untold horrors committed by the Serbs. There's so much undocumented even today. Yeah, like, even from the brief research, you guys don't understand, man, okay? The Serbian government had their military and police forces literally establishing artillery positions to fire over mountainsides to shell the civilian areas of mostly ethnically Albanian people in their own territory. Like, they were establishing, like, military fronts for civilian executions. It was insane.
One has to make a concrete decision every time. My general rule would be, why not Yugoslav, that intervention, Afghanistan, so-so, more yes than no, Iraq,
and
we
Bosnia.
Will see, but basically I think it was a catastrophe in another sense, even if they will succeed in Iraq. Knowingly or unknowingly, and a good politician should know this, should think about this, what de facto happened is that they isolated much more than before United States and the Western idea in general among Arab countries. How hated is now Western liberalism there? This is why my joke about United States...
Wait, somebody in YouTube chat asked, is Vosh a hawk? I think this is one of the big failings of leftist foreign policy, is that they're incapable of distinguishing between being pro-intervention and pro-invasion. To the leftist, there is no... Like, There is no difference between being pro-war and thinking that there are things your country can do abroad, you know? Like, there's no blurry line there. It's just like anytime you do anything outside of your own country, it's war. Unless it's Russia, of course, in which case they're defending themselves against NATO aggression by blah, 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 blah. You know, but yeah, no. I there is absolutely a place for humane intervention, and I know that because I've seen humane intervention happen. We all have, even if some lefties fail to recognize it. The problem is that, like, systemically, America isn't really incentivized to do humane intervention because America sucks. The problem is, it's like, there are avenues for good behavior here, but America doesn't really have the, like, incentive structure to do those things, you know? So how do you push for those, like, good things? Well, I would say that our military support of Ukraine is without question one of the best foreign policy decisions and one of the most ethically justifiable that we've made in the past century. Certainly one of the best that we've made since World War II. It's very unambiguous. We're giving military support to a liberal democracy defending itself from a fascist invasion. It's very straightforwardly a good thing, despite what some lefties might say. That's not intervention, of course. You know, selling weapons to countries that you're allied with. If that was intervention, then every country would always be intervening in every other country's conflicts. And that seems like kind of a broad definition, but pig news. Exactly. Bill Clinton was based. No, Bill Clinton was not based. The only reason that NATO intervened with the whole Yugoslavia thing is because they didn't want a refugee crisis of dirty Slavs. And also because Serbia is basically just miniature Russia. And we want to keep the post-Cold War geopolitical relationship clear with the Russia sphere. It wasn't because they cared about the genocided people. There's a Bill Clinton statue in Kosovo. Really? That's funny. Actually, not a bad one. That is very recognizably Bill Clinton. And then to help you out, it says Bill Clinton at the bottom right there. So that's cool. Here's Hillary Clinton, the less likable of the two, visiting. Yeah, I can't blame the Kosovars or whatever liking Bill Clinton, considering he had the... you know, he had a heavy hand in stopping a genocide of their people.
Is that if there were to be now some kind of a new Stalinist government in United States, the first thing to be would be to arrest George Bush and put him to trial as a traitor and friend of fundamentalists. Because what True. He effectively did is he undermined all American authority so much in Latin America, in Third World, and so on and so on. In a good Stalin situation, he should have confessed that he is a traitor and demanded to be shot or whatever. No, I really think, you see, that's the problem. I know.
See, this is exactly the kind of leftism that I'm talking about, you know? With the crimes that Bush has done in Latin America, he should be tried and shot. And additionally, more NATO intervention abroad. You see, for every NATO intervention that we do, we should take one former war criminal president and shoot them. Only by achieving this balance can we...
Oh, and I know what Michnik and Havel wanted to say when they say, whatever you say... What bad thing is there to overthrow a tyrant like Saddam Hussein? Yes, but the effect on the entire region of global situation was catastrophic. And there is another irony. If you look at Iraq today, it is still undecided what will happen. I mean, do you know that under Saddam, it was nightmare terror, but Saddam's regime was one of the most secular ones, except for the last 2 years. So, paradoxically, the first they said we come there to bring human rights, women's freedom. But wait a minute, the first result till now was that religious fundamentalism grew incredibly more strong. I spoke with some Iranians who told me, wonderful, the United States did the job for us. They got rid of Saddam.
It is so fucking incredible. Dude, you want to speak to failure in American foreign policy, by the way? How fucking wild is it that during the late Cold War, America tossed their chips in with the fucking fundamentalists in the Mujahideen. We lost secular rule of Iran when the Shah was overthrown, and Assad, a secular ruler of Syria, is a complete, like, Russia puppet. How fucked is it that, like, the theoretical pathway for liberalization of the Middle East had to have laid in some kind of, like, moderate secularism, but every avenue for secular leadership from the West either got fucking cooed or got Because the USSR was committing genocide and promoted state atheism. Yeah, how did they like, in the time they were in the Middle East, I feel like they did worse than we did in Afghanistan and still came away ahead. Christ. The relationship between Russia and Assad is a lot stronger than our relationship with modern Iraq, that's for sure. Also, the US overthrew a secular leader in Iran because we know, like, yeah, and then they overthrew our ostensibly secular leader, you know? It keeps fucking happening. It keeps happening.
Now, through them, we can win elections. You see, this is what a good politician should think about. Okay, I'll put it in another way. You know, I will repeat that horrible, cynical Talleyrand wisdom, you know, Napoleon's foreign minister, eternal survivor, when he said once, this is not only a crime, it's much worse, it's a mistake, you know? This is what I'm afraid about, the bombing of Iraq and so on. But again, I don't have these great left cliches, which are American intervention, always a crime. No, it's not as simple as that. Let's see, here and there. I'm only claiming it quite pragmatically what they...
God, I fucking love him. Oh yeah, look up Afghanistan's population. Ah yes, you know the Soviet joke? Soviet invasion of Afghanistan commences, and the Politburo decide they're going to initiate a 5-year plan to reduce the number of starving people in Afghanistan. And by the mid-80s, comrades, great news! There are fewer starving people in Afghanistan, and fewer people in general. Seriously, look at that shit. Just knocked a few million off the population graph right there. Some wild shit. You see that alongside, like, a more nuanced take on interventionism than I've ever heard. It's in a shopping mall. Is he at an airport? I think he's at an airport. I think he's at an airport from these really high ceilings. I can only assume that he's, like, they literally just caught him at a layover. They just ran at him with a camera and just asked him a question, and this is happening now.
It was pretty catastrophic.
Nah, he was doing mall security that day. Slavoj does not travel with any possessions, so he ran out of money, and in order to pay his way to a speaking gig in America, he's doing some airport cop shit. I know this airport is in Warsaw. That does seem like the kind of place he would be. Based Biden throwback moment.
Different. I'm just want to know what you suggest, because back then, when I was in your position, I was suggesting we bomb Belgrade. I was suggesting that we send American pilots in and blow up all the bridges on the Drina. I was suggesting we take out his oil supplies. I was suggesting very specific action.
And isn't it interesting?
I was suggesting we nuke everything east. Everything east of Poland. Bomb everything. How many Serbian lives are you willing to take, Biden? Bucko, by the time I'm done, there won't even be a Serbia to account those lives by.
Days, now comes the dirty conclusion, I warn you, it's really dirty. In the good old days of really existing socialism, a joke was popular
Fine.
Among dissidents. A joke used to illustrate the futility of their protests. In the 15th century Russia, occupied by Mongols, that's the joke, a farmer and his wife walk along a dusty country road. A Mongol warrior on a horse stops at their side and tells the farmer that he will now rape his wife. He then adds, but since there is a lot of dust on the ground, you should hold my testicles while I'm raping your wife so that they will not get dusty, dirty. After the Mongol finishes his job and rides away, the farmer starts to laugh and jump with joy. The surprised wife asks him, how can you be jumping with joy when I was just brutally raped? The farmer answers, but I got him. His balls are full of dust. This sad joke tells of the predicament of dissidents. They thought they were...
But I got him.
Dealing serious blows to the party nomenclatura, but all they were doing were, well, getting a little bit of dust on the nomenclatura's testicles. Is today's critical left all too often not in a similar position? We think we are doing something terribly subversive. We are just... Our task is to discover how to make a step further. Our thesis 11 today should be, critical leftists have hitherto only dirtied with dust the balls of those in power. The point is to cut them off.
So you were talking about some of these like long-term issues, like ecological problems, which the negative effects are, you know, 50 years or 100 years down the line. What kind of social changes do you think, or political changes do you think would be needed to, for us to be able to keep those in mind, or to be able to have an effect on those? Because capitalist systems, you know, they care about things on the quarter by quarter level or election by election level, and that doesn't really work with these longer term issues that kind of have like a big impact.
It's a difficult question because I don't have a concrete answer. All I can say is that, now I will say something horrible, which you may consider doubt, but you mentioned this quarter by quarter.
She's like getting ready to answer literally any question. Now I'm going to say something horrible, something dirty, something very depraved, but hold on, hold on.
Quarter or election by election. Mm-hmm. I think that even a new form of mobilization, international, will have to be found, which will not be immediately depending on our today's sense of logic of parliamentary democracy. I'm not playing, don't be afraid, any Stalinist game of true people's democracy. I'm just saying this. Are you aware that, and I'm talking about our political democracies, an effectively functioning democracy.
Zizek is a Disco Elysium character in real life. I think that's actually a really apt description of him, isn't it? He is. He is. You can very easily imagine him being painted in that impasto style.
Democracy is only possible against the background of a certain basic ideological homogeneity. We must agree on many basic procedures. That's why I think, if you ask me, even you in the United States here, if you are from here, I don't know, are in a dangerous moment. This split now between, let's say, Bernie Sanders and Trump is too strong to be contained in a simple electoral process. Why? Because ultimately there is no compromise here. One side has to win. It's the struggle is much stronger. So what I am saying is that some kind of transnational bodies with a strong executive power to prevent this false ecology, which is ecology of protecting just ourselves. For example, I was a couple of years ago in, how do you pronounce it, Iceland, the country whose capital is Reykjavik, is?
Iceland.
Okay, I'm not sure. And they had a big movement about, they want to build some phosphate metal manipulation factory, which would be bad for their coast, which is otherwise extremely clean and so on. They said no. And I told them, but they're ecologists. I attacked them in a TV debate. They invited me. I told them, so for you, it's okay to build it somewhere else, you know. Just no, we want our island there clean and so on. This attitude of it's not enough to say we don't want it here. It's we don't want it in general, or where, how do we do it? We need to learn a global approach. Let me give you another example of this ethical revolution. I've written about it. My friend, who is otherwise a right-winger, but an intelligent one, Peter Sloterdijk.
Why is he wearing the Chris Chan shirt? Because a long time ago, Chris Chan and Zizek separated, like Piccolo and Kami. And this is the older, wiser form. And they're weaker separate. One day they'll reunite, be very powerful.
Like the German guy. He said that, are we aware to what extent till now our entire ethics is an ethics of war, of sacrifice? We live our ordinary lives, earn money, pleasures, but the true ethical test is war. Are you ready to sacrifice your life for your country? This is the ultimate ethical act. So, Hegel consequently conceptualized this. He said this is the paradox, that our entire ethical life within the country has at its foundation, it's the ultimate ethical act, war, which is international return to barbarism. In today's global society with ecological dangers, whatever, we have somehow to overcome this
ethics. And the only way I see it is just through gradual awareness, because I don't think incidentally we have half a century, if you ask me. I think less. It will be, you know, maybe it's already even happening, we are just not aware of it. This gradual changes. Look, forget about drought in Africa. Look what's happening in northeastern Siberia, where that permafrost is melting. And you know that more of this, what are those bad gases that out of car fumes they come?
Carbon dioxide?
Yeah. You know that though, from that melting of permafrost, more this dioxide is already going into the air than all the cars combined and so on. We are already in such tremendous changes. So I think that literally some kind of global emergency state will be needed. It will come. I don't worry about will it come or not. I just worry that maybe it will come too fast. But you know what literally demoralizes me? How the rich people are already aware of it. I have a friend in New Zealand who told me, you know how many rich people are already buying properties in New Zealand?
Yep.
Because they think if it's a global ecological catastrophe, they are even far away, 3 hours flight south, even from Australia, it's the safest place, and so on. So, again, I think that it's not just more democracy. It is more democracy, but also, something horrible to say, a stronger, even more authoritarian state power. I don't have an easy answer.
Yes, I agree completely.